Excuse me.
Yeah.
Is that your car on the lot?
Yeah.
Is it Jag?
Yeah.
Make a lot of money?
Yeah, I do all right for myself.
I'm trying to put it together. Nice car. Mm-hmm. We live in the same building. I'm not understand how much money you make.
I don't know. $70,000 last month. I'm serious.
Yeah, no, I'm serious too. Seriously, how much money you make?
I told you, $70,000. Well, technically, $72,000 last month.
You made $72,000 in 1 month.
Yeah.
I tell you what. You show me a pay stub for $72,000 on it, I quit my job right now and I work for you. Hey, Paulie, what's up? No, no, everything's fine. Hey, listen, I quit.
All right. Sheesh. Man, I could not think of a better introduction to kick today's episode off. Man, I am excited for today. The individual that we got going on here is just like that. I felt like that clip was just absolutely necessary. But before we get started introducing him, what's up, Jordan? How you feeling, bro?
What's good? Happy Friday, bro. Glad to be here. Yo, he showed me this trading thing.
I just called my people up. I was like, yo, I quit. Literally, this is like life story. He shows people these things and then people are like, yeah, hey, Paulie, listen, I quit. That's how it works, man. That's how it works. This guy, I remember, impressed me the first time I actually talked. This is the first conversation I ever had with this guy. He told me he wanted to be on Forbes 30. I don't know if he remembers this, but I do. He said he wanted to be on Forbes 30 by 30. And I had never met anybody in my life that had ever said that. So that's how I knew that this guy was legit. What was your first experience with this guy?
Me?
Way different.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Dude, me and Mike go way back. So I went to... I'm from Wisconsin, right? I'm from Illinois, Wisconsin, and I decided to go to school at Chicago. So my first day at school at university, like my mom, my grandpa, they dropped me off. They left me. I'm chilling there. Don't know anybody there. I knew one person, actually. I knew his name was Akash. I met him in like the engineering, like the summer thing we went to before. So I hit up Akash like, yo, what's up, Akash? He's like, yo, come through. Come chill. I come in his dorm room and guess who's sitting on the bed? Freaking Mike Navarrete, right? Rest is history. So yeah, I met this guy in 2013, freshman year in college. We became boys throughout college and we really did some crazy stuff. So it's insane for me to see like where he's been, what we used to do together to what we do together now and the growth in this guy. Yeah, it's been, I've seen him come like all the way from 0 to 100. So it's been insane. It's been insane. I've been looking forward to this episode for a while.
Yeah, facts. Me too, man. Me too. It's been good, man. Obviously, Mike, thank you for being on here, bro. I appreciate you. You're on the other side of the world, and for you to take the time out of your day, bro, on this beautiful, beautiful Friday afternoon to just come kick it with us, share some value. I'm super excited. Obviously, we know you, bro, but for people that have no idea who you are, man, how does Mike Navarrete explain himself? How do you describe yourself? Tell us your story, bro.
Well, first of all, I just want to get some gratitude. Yeah, this is going to be so much fun just because we share a lot of history between all of us. And then we've also come from different places. And I'm sure at some point, Jordan and I will talk about some ridiculous thing that we did under different types of mindsets. And so it's really cool, man, to be doing this with you guys. Chilling right now in Costa Rica. So this is, man, one of the coolest places out there for sure. But, yo, like... I'll tell you what, I'll start with where I was, who I was, and then kind of, I guess, like where I am now. You know, before I guess, I'd say like, if you ask me how old I am, I'd probably tell you I'm like 6-7 years old. I guess that's really how I would start. I'm just getting started here. But it really, because I think that's just when I became a lot more conscious of like who I really wanted to be and who I wanted to become. But I mean, starting off like, I've always been someone who just like, bro, I just love having experience. Early on, I chose to kind of take a different path. I first started with like, you know, hey, play these sports like you're just naturally good at. these things, you should do that. And then that way you'll, you know, go to a good school and all that stuff. So one of my first major failures was dropping out of basically like high level soccer. And I like to start with that because that's the moment where I chose my happiness and definitely chose my dad's frustrations. So like that was the first time where yeah, I was like, I'm really disappointed in you. But I think it's such a pivotal moment in your life because I think there's just so many things that we do for other people. Like there's so many choices that we make for our own lives that are to make other people happy or to just not go through a certain conversation. And so I think that's kind of like a little bit where all that started. But I mean, for me in the beginning, it was just, I had amazing parents, you know, like they're just OGs, hardworking people, like good quality people. But my mindset was a lot smaller, you know, it was like more enclosed. I didn't know anything about anything. And that's something that has stayed the same. I still don't know shit about shit. So at least that part has stayed the same, but I became aware that there is more to know. And so, yeah, man, like Jordan and I go back, like we had some very, like we like to call D-gen, right? Like some D-gen moments. And I think we still have those. They're just a little bit different on a different scale about maybe more quality things. But, you know, I'm coming from a place, bro, where like, when Jordan and I really started to hang out, it was when I was living in a basement, like in our building, but I didn't have a room. Like it wasn't an actual room. It was a hallway. And I just put a curtain over the hallway and you had to go through my room to get to the laundry room. So that's like kind of where I got started. And like, I think when I started to become a little, wake up a little bit more. So definitely humble beginnings, man. But I just feel like that, I kind of never let that define me. And it's just been an uphill, like not an uphill battle. It's just been an uphill experience. And I think it stays like that. But yeah, man, just coming from that place, bro. Like I remember in college, it was just a lot of boredom because in there, I felt like I just wasn't fulfilled. I don't know. You guys probably have had similar experiences. It was just like it's a lack of fulfillment. And so, yeah, man, coming from a place where I just didn't know what I really wanted, so that I wasn't really giving my full to anything really, looking for something to do. I chose the Air Force, terrible idea. And everyone could tell you, Jordan probably butt in here, but it was like one of the most sideways, like out of nowhere decisions ever. And it's like, wait, what are you doing? So it was so funny going through that and experiencing, because at that point I actually chose other people or what I thought other people thought I should be at in my life. And so that was like interesting because that's when I didn't choose like really who I wanted to be. I chose like, all right, I should probably be responsible and, you know, do all these things to have a stable, you know, boring fucking life. So anyways, after that, I think I started to really see like, all right, this is the matrix in front of me. Like I got so deep into the matrix that I was able to see it as what it was. And then I was like, all right, perfect. This is exactly what I never want to experience. So man, yeah, that's kind of like, I guess some of the foundation to like where I was, it's just kind of not a closed mind, but I just had never been approached. I had never been become aware of so much out there, not just like business, but just how the mind works, you know, what we're capable of doing, the rules, the standards of life that you can have. So, yeah, I mean, I'm grateful that I went through a lot of like a lot of the bullshit, a lot of the status quo, the cookie cutter lifestyle, because I don't think like the law of polarity, I feel like once you understand both sides, that's when like you really can come from a place of awareness. And so, yeah, man, like, bro, I'm grateful to be where I am now. Like, you know, I was having a conversation yesterday with someone, and it's funny. I hope my parents at some point see this, but I was saying how like just existing is an anomaly, right? Mm-hmm. Like you guys have heard it, like, oh, you know, you beat out trillions of swimmers or something like that, right? But how I came to be, no pun intended, is my mom was going to move. Like she was going to leave Illinois. She was like dipping out. Her brothers had something going on in like the East Coast. And my dad was like, nah, you're not moving. Like, you're not leaving. Because they weren't married yet. They were just dating. And so he got her pregnant on purpose.
Savage. Secured the bag.
Savage. Bro, he secured the bag. So he got her pregnant on purpose so that she wouldn't move. And so that, she, you know, they're locked in. And then, you know, I think my mom, I don't know how many months pregnant she was when they got married. But it's so funny, bro, because I'm like, dude, I was like, I was very intentional. like my creation was so intentional. And, you know, I got to be here now. So, you know, and I didn't always think like this, but I always look back to this now. And I'm like, all right, cool. Like, you know, there's a reason that the universe inspired for me to be here. So I guess I might as well do something about it. But I mean, now to me, like, man, my vision is just to be an example for people to just choose to live the life that they want. I don't really know if it's about, I don't really think there's time freedom. I don't really think there's financial freedom either, but I think we get options. And I think that's like, at least for me, like what I aspire to do is just help people see that they have options and then at least be a part of their growth so that they can just decide what it is that they want to do. Because at the end of the day, bro, there's unlimited options.
Yeah, dude, you're definitely giving that freedom to me and thousands of other people. I've traveled around the world with you, seen you like literally give that value and put that energy and spirit into so many people. And that's why you're so highly regarded. If you don't know who this guy is, just check his Instagram, check his YouTube. Like, amount of value he provides on a daily, consistent basis is insane, bro. You're a machine. That's something I've always looked up to you.
Appreciate you.
I'm like, this guy never stops, bro. Like, yo, let's chill. He's like, no, I got more people to say. But I wanted to follow up on a question. Like, you said that you were 6 or 7 years old in terms of, and I got what you meant by that in sense of like, you discovered a whole new world of possibilities, a bunch of new information. Mm-hmm. What was that moment for you, if you could recall going back? Like, what was that awakening moment?
Yeah, you know, I've been looking back to see like, all right, when did it happen? Like, when did it really, like the birth, if you want to say, like that conscious birth? I haven't really been able to pinpoint it because I think it's like, and maybe you guys have had a similar experience where you have like a first, like a flash of like consciousness. And then you kind of dims and you kind of disappear for a while and then it happens again. So I think the first time that I really just, I think the first time I questioned everything that I ever knew, I was like 17 years old. And that was my first acid trip. So it was like my reality was just, it's like life just bitch slaps you. And then it's like, LOL, you thought. And so, yeah, I think like that was kind of the first time I said it. I was like 17 years old. I remember, you know, in physics, they teach you about like vibration, but they don't, I don't know. I didn't connect the dots for me. I didn't like understand like, all right, cool. You know, things are vibrating. Okay, cool. Like, I don't know what that means. But I think that experience of like the wall was genuinely wiggly. And I was like, it was the first time it connected. Like, oh my God, like everything is just space. Like it's all moving all the time. And it's like, that's how everything communicates. And it was just like, oh, what? Like, why is this not like, you know, hey, you're 6 years old. This is what's actually happened. So that's, I guess, like the first thing. And then I woke up and like, not in a physical sense, but like all of a sudden I started to just question so many things. Like what even is thinking? I remember asking myself that. I'm like, I'm thinking about thinking. What? And so yeah, that's like the first time. And then I think over the years, I just had different ways of that. I don't think you need psychedelics to get to that point or anything like that. I think you can definitely just like come to understanding and questioning things. But that was definitely the first time that I think I just got that like wake up call where it was like, huh. I've kind of just been, life has just been going by. Like I haven't been consciously creating my life. It's just things that just been happening. Mm-hmm. And I'm just kind of just reacting to everything that happens. And so, but yeah, I think that was like the first choice. Cause I even went to college blindly. You know what I mean? Like, I was just like, I guess this is what you do. So let me just go do that thing. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I think it was like at that point, I say music has a lot of influence too. Like, it's a lot of subconscious influence. But it wasn't until, like really, 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 I think, yeah, definitely in college when all of a sudden you're like, huh, all these beliefs I have, like, where do they even come from? Like, why do I even like the color blue? Why do I like the color red? So, yeah, it kind of starts over there. But that's what I meant. Like, I feel like I'm, I guess, maybe, like, 6, 7 years old just because I feel like it hasn't been until now that every decision, or at least most decisions, I go to make them with an intention instead of just like
reaction.
You know? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I could relate to, I think everybody like who's been through that sort of awakening experience, like questioning reality, like what the hell am I doing here? It's not just all at once, but it's like, there's like little glimpses and like,
yeah,
psychedelics are one way you can glimpse beyond that. Beyond your mind, essentially, you can break your mind and see beyond what your traditional thoughts are in a whole new way. And bro, I just gotta shout out, I'm so grateful that you were there while I was experiencing some of those things, because you definitely had more experience than me, and you definitely brought it back to reality a few times. Mondo, can you give me a host permission real quick? I gotta share this meme, because dude, this is Mike like to a freaking T. Like, dude, I've had the benefit of exploring my mind with you and Mondo a few times, but this one always brings me back, bro. This is Mike, man. This is Mike. This is me. Like, you're always that guy, man. Like, it bring it center, keep it like the vibes chill. Yeah, like, keep things together when things would get all loopy and weird, bro. And you've always had that sense of just groundedness, man. You've always had that to me. And I kind of, another question before, I'm gonna sneak another question in before Mylon gets a chance. Dude, what is that? I've always been like mystified by it. Like, I just don't understand. What keeps you grounded, bro? Like, what keeps you,
it's a great
to
question.
You, like, so humble? Like, what keeps you centered?
I feel like this is, over time, I've started to see this answer more often, but I think it's definitely a nurture kind of thing. I'd say that like the one of the most just pure people that I know is my mom. And so I think she just kind of set that standard for me. And I didn't know that until way later. But like, I can believe that people are genuinely good. Like I don't have to go and imagine that there's just really good people in the world. Because I just got to experience that. And I got to experience that like my whole life. And so I didn't really realize that this is what I think, like kind of where that comes from. But all of a sudden it's like, you know, and there's that phrase, if you want to change the world, it starts with changing yourself. And so one of the things that also combines with, you know, how are you always like, I wouldn't say on the grind, but just like mission oriented or process driven. And I think it's because of the same thing. Like, I want to be that person that, like, you look at me and it's not like things I have, but it's just who I am. And then that way you don't have an excuse. Like, my goal is to eliminate excuses for anybody about anything, you know? And so as far as just like our kind of type of business, I feel like that's what been my bro, like, it's always been like, I want to be that person so that anyone can believe that they can get it done. And that I think it's the same thing with like just being grounded, being present. It's just, I know that, for example, like in psychedelic experiences, when you know that someone's going through foreign territory and you know you've been through that territory, it's like, all right, cool. Like, let me just be that that pilot that helps you land, you know, land the plane. Okay. And that way you can get to where you want to get to faster. And yes, I think it stems from just having honestly really good influence, and then also having not that good influence, but being able to see both. Because I know you guys have seen it. There's some people that had like, you know, like really messed up parents, and like they messed them up, whether it's like alcohol, abuse, whatever it is, or just they're just maybe not good people. And so there's things that I, you know, growing up that I saw that I didn't like. And instead of like becoming that person, it was like, awesome, now I know exactly what not to do. So I guess I got a good dichotomy of both. And so now it's just like, it kind of became my, like, that's just like the frequency that I like to be at.
You know, I think it's crazy that we just kind of like, you know, I think because we've all interacted together that like we just straight just jumped into like something super, super deep. Like it's just phenomenal to like get into conversation so naturally with somebody like you. And I was just thinking as Jordan was asking these questions, like, man, you've taught me so much without any acid, you know, that it's like, it's like, for real, you know, it's like, because I've had just like these breakthroughs that people, you know, you said it, you don't need psychedelics to get through that experience. I feel like some of those experiences I've had without any, some have had with, but just I kind of want to get into some, because there's a lot of things that you are, I would say, very good at. One of the things that Jordan and I think every episode that we've done, we've shouted you out for something or another, right? And one of the things that was it, just because you have such a big influence, and not in just our life, but like literally everybody, and I'm sure you know that, and you get praised on it a lot, but I don't think you can be told that enough, man. Like you really do help a lot of people. But outside of that, man, like I want to know, like there was one thing that really stuck out to me when we were at the Renaissance. I think you remember this, right? And you're like, I was like, something about pissing you off, right? And you're like, I don't get pissed off. And Jordan was, I think we mentioned this too. He's just like, one of the guys that just doesn't ever get angry or doesn't ever get upset at anything is like Mike. Like Mike just never, he's just always like calm. He's always just so collected. Like, how do you get to that point, man? Because there are so many people in the world that's like, you know, I'll use the weather as an example, right? It's too hot in the summer. It's too cold in the winter. Like they can never be okay. So like, imagine when something happens in life and it's just so tragic, especially in, you know, the industry that we're in with trading and emotions and the current state of like the market and stuff like that. Like, is it like, I know it's for you, it's you're like a big role model in my emotions. It's like, well, if something is happening to me, I think like, seriously, like, I think like, damn, would Mike be pissed off at this? Like, would Mike react to this? The answer most of the time is no. But how do you get to that point, man? Like, how did you evolve to that point as a human, as a conscious being, to not let anything affect you? Like, yeah, you can get emotional for a second, but like, how do you not become that?
So I love these questions, by the way. I'm glad that you guys are doing this podcast, because you two are some of my favorite people in general, but asking questions, that's a gift that you both have. Like, you both really have that gift. And I've told you both this, like, and separately, independently, and then you doing this together, which I was like, why is that so perfect? But in regards to, I guess, frustrations, you know, emotions, and whether you choose them or not, I think, again, you get to experience them in the beginning a lot. And I skateboarded my whole life, and you get really mad. You get really mad sometimes. I don't know if Jordan ever saw me blow up before, like with the skateboard, but because actually by the time me and Jordan met, I had already injured myself, so I wasn't really at that caliber anymore. But going through that, you just like the repetitions of failure and frustrations are so compact. Like, you just literally fuck up so much, so fast, so often, that you kind of get dull. To me, I just kind of ended up getting, I guess, desensitized to it. And I didn't get it, because like, I feel like there's skill sets that people have that they don't understand how or why they have them. They just have them. And I never wanted to be that person. I didn't want to be talented. I wanted to be able to reverse engineer everything and be able to duplicate it. So when it comes to just the emotional side of things, I heard a phrase maybe like 4 years ago, and it was, you know, basically, long story short, you'll feel without becoming. And that was something that was so simple. Feel without becoming. And I was like, I remember hearing that, and it was longer, but all of a sudden it became separate. Like, for the first time in my life, I saw and realized that who you are and what you feel are two separate things. And I never knew that. And I think most people don't know that. I think, like, hey, you know, we just feel, you know, frustrated, happy, excited, mad, sad, depressed, anxious, whatever it is. You know, these things come. They just show up. Same thing with your thoughts. They just show up. You're like, hey, where the fuck did this come from, you know? Same with emotions, they just show up because of what we've been trained and just what we've experienced. So all of a sudden this feeling shows up and I realized that I choose it. Like I choose to, you know, embody that feeling. And once that, like once that clicked for me, once it was just like, huh, I'm just choosing if I want this one or not. It's that simple. And I always give the example where when you get a phone call, you have an option, accept or deny.
Ooh, that's gold.
And I know Jordan just has me on, he's got me blocked, but you know, but accept and deny, it says, so you get a choice. And that was like it for me. And that helped me so much because to, I guess, just go beyond that, you know, when something happens, honestly, like, I realized like, huh, that kind of has nothing to do with me. Like, it's happening, like this is going on, but it doesn't have nothing to do with me. It's not like I can't really change it. So that's where I remember Bob Proctor once said, you know, it's not that you're in a circumstance, it's that you are the circumstance. And I remember hearing that, I was like, huh. So it really, like, if you have all the power, you also have the ability to just decide not to be involved. Mm-hmm. And I remember, you know, one of our mentors, Alex Morin, he was talking about, you know, COVID, and he's, you know, he was asking his mentor, Bob Proctor, he's like, you know, what are your thoughts on COVID? What are your thoughts on all this stuff? And he's like, oh, yeah, I just refuse to participate. Just like that. All of a sudden, the whole thing is just not relevant to him anymore. And he just goes on and lives his life. Rest in peace. But yeah, it's kind of like that, man. It's like, all right, all these things that are happening around me, what do I have power over? And the one thing I have power over is if I choose to this emotion or not. And it's practice, I guess, from there.
At what point does that become ignorance, though? Because, like, for example, like, if you were just oblivious to COVID and, or, you know, just bringing it back to that, like, if you're just oblivious to that and oblivious to people's feelings and, like, their emotions behind what's happening, and, you know, for example, they might have lost a loved one, so they're emotionally attached to whatever circumstance is happening, and to you, you're just like, that's not, I don't accept that in my reality. At what point does that become ignorance for you not to become that, or, like, not to participate in that?
That's a really good question. I think the beginning of that question is why it makes sense is you're not oblivious. It's a conscious choice. It's a consistent conscious choice. So it's just, I'm not going to allow that in. It's happening. You can't, like, it's happening, but I'm just not allowing it to consume me. And so of course, you know, people are affected and, like, you're empathetic, but that I'm not going to allow there to be an exchange of energy because, like, oh, cool, this is my route. Like, all right, you know, I have empathy, but I would say ignorance. You're not being ignorant to it either. You're very well aware. Because you're aware, you can choose to not be involved. I don't know, like, at least that's how I see it, you know?
Yeah, dang.
Yeah, like, how do you separate yourself from your thoughts and emotions? Like, do you have a specific strategy or exercise, like a ways to, like, people can practice that? Because I think, and I'm honored bringing that up, that's such a perfect point because, like, it's like the dual layer of what we were just talking about, like, all right, I'm choosing to separate myself from COVID. And then now you have maybe someone that you are emotionally connected to that is involved in that. And now you have to, again, make that choice of separating yourself from there. Like, what is the strategy to doing that? And how do you deal with that when it comes to people that are closest to you that might not be on the same frequency that you're on?
So I think it has to do with detachment to, like, result or opinion. Like, there's people that I know, if I go in a certain topic, it's gonna be warfare, right? If I choose to do that. So do I want to have that conversation because I just want to be right, or do I want to have that conversation because I believe someone, you know, should just be aware of these things? So it's like, why do I even want to actually have this conversation? Is it because I want to feed the ego a little bit, and I want to prove that, like, I know my shit, or I'm right, or you're wrong? And I think a lot of the times, like, those kind of things come from because you just want to show, like, and I don't know if it's just, like, naturally in us, but it's like a, I think, a dominance. This is power. But I think the most powerful people are the ones that know they don't have to. They don't have to show it.
It's like when you got a bunch of. It's like when you got a bunch of money and you don't really have to tell anybody that you got a bunch of money.
Yeah, man. Like, I've had the luxury of seeing like the scales of wealth from, you know, like I remember being exposed to my first six-figure earner, multiple six-figure earner, then seven figures, and then eight figures. And I remember like the move from six to eight figures, it was like the flexing was just, bro, it just got crazy. You know, and I'm like, holy, like, dude, like, you gotta be or look like this person to, you know, really demonstrate wealth. And then I think I started to notice once people, and this isn't a perfect example, but people that got to like 50 mil, 100 mil and beyond, all of a sudden, like the priorities just in the mind, the peace of mind became so different. Like, it's like if you're rich and you're rich as fuck, like you had to like, you know, yo guys, check it out. I fucking made it. Like, I did that thing, you know, and it's like the pride and, you know, it, maybe it's new territory, you know, you work so hard and it's like everyone who doubted me and, you know, all those things. It's, I think it's just like an ego thing. But I think once you really just genuinely become someone powerful, someone of wealth, you start to, I think, just look at things differently because like the amount of dollars that keep going up matter less. It's like the marginal difference becomes such so little. It's like, oh, cool, I made another million. Like, it actually doesn't make a difference in my life anymore. What's more important in my life now? Like, peace of mind, whether it's, you know, being happy or just choosing to not be whatever frustrated. So I think just like it's a shift on priorities because it goes from, you know, scarcity mindset to, you know, just feeling good, feeling secure, to, you know, being to a point of financial abundance that you're like, well, all right, cool, I won that game. Well, there's a bigger game. And so how do I, you know, win this one? And so I guess like, I think, I don't know, just to add to your topic and what you were saying, I think that's just like, I've seen that and I see people go through it and it's so cool, bro. So I think if you already have that kind of mindset before, like, or while you're in your like financial come up, I think everything probably happens faster.
Since we're on the subject of money, man, my favorite subject. What's your play right now? What's your play right now? So obviously crypto markets are a bloodbath. Today was a good rally for the stock market. I don't think you do too much stocks, like actually investing into stocks. But like, what is your play right now for everything that's going on? Obviously dollar is daddy. Right. So are you more liquid now or are you still buying assets? Like, are you taking advantage of these market lows? What's your current play right now?
So this is a really good question. And I think the answer is definitely based on your skill set and what you know and what you feel good about what you know. So yes, dollar is daddy. Dollar is definitely daddy. I haven't really been buying too much crypto for the last, it's probably like 5 months, 6 months, a little bit, you know, and just a couple of new things that caught my radar that I, you know, just dollar cost averaging too, which is cool. But my play right now has been like, especially for, I'd say probably the last 5-6 months has been NFTs. So my shift in my cash flow just went in a completely different direction, similar directions, but just different things. And it's been definitely heavy into NFTs. And I would say that could be a dangerous play for some people. I definitely want to say that. Like, and I don't know if it is the play for most people, just being real. Under, like, if you don't have guidance or experience, because just being transparent, like, a lot of NFTs are just shit. Like, they're just, like, a big, big pile of steamy caca. And it's, but, like, I had to paint the picture because and the funny thing is I love the NFTs, but I'm not naive enough to just glorify them. And I don't know, man, like that's a really common thing that happens. I think with just different industries is like, we glorify the whole thing when it's like, it's not perfect. It just might be better. And they go to anything, bro, like real estate, trading, investing, cryptos, anything that we do or that is done, they have, there's flaws. And so with this space, like there's major flaws, but man, there's a lot of like arbitrage. There's a lot of just places where you can make money. So for me, like NFTs, even if like crypto is just dying, like let's just say just a bloodbath. There's a thing that, and I'm sure Jordan, like you've seen it, it's like one ETH is one ETH. It's not like, oh, one ETH is this dollar amount, now it's this dollar amount, now it's this dollar amount. It's just an ETH. And I saw this happen because for those of you who don't know, what day is it? Like 13th of May, something like that?
Friday the 13th, man.
Friday the 13th. All right. It's my lucky day. So we just saw a couple of days of just in slaughterhouse. And people are just like, man, I've lost so much. And I'm like, okay, so like you still don't get it. You still don't get it, huh? And this is like 97% of people in the space. I'm like, damn, like no wonder you have these feelings. Because to clarify, you're still looking at what you own back in dollars, or you're still comparing it to something else instead of it being what it is. And so like for me, you know, being involved in like Solana NFTs and ETH NFTs, it's a whole different thing because sure, the value of those currencies maybe at the moment had dropped, or the price of them, because the value and price are very different things. But the price of those things, and if you guys don't notice, like I'm really careful and selective with my words. Like I like to say what it is. And bro, I've realized over time, we don't actually ever say what we're meaning to say. It's crazy. Like I was like listening to myself and I'm like, dude, I didn't actually say what I was trying to say. But anyways, that's a whole different conversation. But yeah, NFTs have kind of been the play for me. One, because there's different opportunities all the time. There's short-term, long-term things going on. And it's like, imagine there's an ICO every single day. That's kind of what it's like with NFTs. And there's a ton of them. You don't have to choose them all or every day, but there are new options to make good ROI frequently in the space or play in the secondary market. So, you know, something launches, is something that you like, it's quality, and what happens? This market's got ebbs and flows, man. This is an up and down type of situation. So catching, you know, higher lows, being able to, I guess, you know, step away from FOMO, step away from the hype, and let the market come to where it really should be at, and then making those moves, that's where I thrive. Like, I don't spend time, you know, getting whitelisted. I don't really do any of that. It's not worth my time. But if I know something's good and I know if it's at a good price, cool, I'll run that play. So that's kind of where I'm at right now. Like, I like being active with my money. And I like being in the field, you know, I like being in the trenches. So yeah, that's kind of what I'm doing more than anything. And then just like, you know, day trading as it has been for a long time.
Freaking El Mago at day trading. But I want to continue to talk about NFTs. You said 97% of people still don't understand. That was like, I think such a huge bar that might've went over a lot of people's heads because today, right, the market is down, what, 40, 50, 60, whatever percent. But the amount of coins, if you had 1,000 Cardano, you still have 1,000 Cardano. If you had half a Bitcoin, you still have half a Bitcoin, right? Mm. The value of that is different, but you still hold the assets, which like you said, I just wanted to reiterate that because that was such an important point. Like that's the whole point of crypto. Like you decide to hold these assets and these things are more valuable. And on that topic, the difference between price and value, which is another gem. Like, Mike, you drop so many gems, people just miss, bro. Just miss. You just be like crossing them out, bro. So I want to slow it down, go recap on some of these things because when it comes to price and value, obviously the market determines price. That goes up and down. There's a lot of factors that will affect the price. And we have an entire academy built to that. And you guys study and teach us that every single day about the market flow and why prices go up and down. I don't really want to talk about that, but I want to more talk about the value. Because I think finding value in NFTs and crypto is a little more subjective. And that's the thing that separates you as an investor in the space or someone looking to accumulate assets, right? Invest in things that are going to grow with expected price returns. So how do you sort And how do you find value besides price, right? What are you looking for in NFTs? What are you looking for in cryptos? What are the things that draw your eyes? And you say, ooh, that's valuable.
bro, one of our favorite quotes, or one of the more important things, I guess I apply to it, is observe the masses and do the opposite. So, for example, on the radio, when you hear a song, it's following a formula. Like any radio-friendly song, anything that's getting massively distributed, for the most part, it's following a formula that has been proven to sell music, that has been proven to cater to the majority of people. And I think NFTs have this same thing. I think there's someone does something and it blows up. And then all of a sudden, the market becomes saturated in the same type of thing. So all of a sudden, every single project is doing staking. Every single project is breeding. Every single project is, you know, making this, this, or that, whatever it is. And so for me, it's become so simple. It's like, as soon as something just stands out and I'm like, this is a different angle. All right. Yeah. There will be attention. Attention is going to come here because they're not taking the safe route to what's, you know, quote unquote worked, which is almost impossible to say because everything happens so fast in the NFT space, like so fast, you know, to 5 months is 20 years in the space. And so, yeah, I guess what I look for is a different approach, something like just genuinely unique. I really took a big lesson last year in March after seeing the explosion of some meme coins, because I had underestimated the power of culture. And that was something that my ego didn't let me invest into because it just didn't do anything. It was just literally, it was just hype. You know, it's a meme. Shiba, Doge, like it's a meme. And so it's like, well, what the fuck does this thing even do? Nothing, literally nothing. But what I realized that it was doing something. It was bringing people together. It was mission oriented. And I was like, and then I wasn't until, you know, I saw like some of my people multiply money in ways I've never seen in my life. And meanwhile, I had that play at the same time, but I didn't run it. And I'm glad that happened because I was able to learn. Cause like, I could have just been like, nah, dude, fuck that. They're just shit coins. They made their run. But it's like, all right, cool. You would like, man, I've been able to learn from things that I don't like, people who I don't like. And I think that's what has always helped me keep progressing, is like, I just disconnect from whatever, like my perspective, how I feel about, just because I don't like you or just because I don't like what you stand for, doesn't mean I can't learn something from you. Doesn't mean you can't be doing things right. I don't remember where, but I was like, if someone's making more money than you, if someone's, you know, out competing you, if someone has more skill sets than you, then you don't like them, too bad, because they're still doing something that you're not. And that's a big, big difference. So when it comes down to NFTs and culture, you know, the PFP space, what does it do? Like, you just, yo, like, I got an ape. Like, we lit. And then it's like, all right, cool. Like, all right, like, that's it, huh? And it's like, all right, well, fuck that. It's just a profile picture. Like, what does it do? Is this a Ponzi? And maybe, but what I think it is identity. One, it's a symbol of identity. Two, it's a social symbol. You know, social currency is so valuable now. And so it shows the world what you're aligned with, who you're aligned with, or who you are connected to. And that carries weight. So it's like, if you got a member, for example, all right, let's say all three of us like to work out. I got a membership to Planet Fitness. Mono's got a membership to, I don't know, let's say Lifetime, but then Jordan's working out with the Bulls every day. Yeah, I wish we're all doing the same thing, but we are at different levels in memberships. And so that's one thing that really separates people. But I'm not really here to give an NFT sermon. That wasn't really the point. But yeah, man, I look for obviously utility, and that's a tough one. You don't really like find a lot of utility in the space. So I guess for me, it's like, what stands out to me? What is being useful? And are people rallying behind a message or an idea? And if those things are happening, I usually like to pull the trigger on it. And nostalgia, man. Nostalgia pays back. Like, don't underestimate the power of nostalgia, because when people, like, one of the most powerful things in the world is your memory. And what that feeling, that feeling that you get when you go back, dude, that's always different. Whenever, like, man, how many times have you probably said, yo, man, that takes me back? Anytime you are, like, right there, that right there, underneath that, that's a big-ass dollar sign. Like, just being blunt, bro. People, like, for example, what kind of TV shows did you guys watch when you were younger? Like, 6, 7, 8 years old?
SpongeBob SquarePants.
Jimmy Turner, Fairly Odd Parents.
Jimmy Neutron.
So now imagine those things, like, let's say there's a phrase that's said, and all of a sudden that triggers that memory. Bro, immediately you just get, like, boom, endorphins.
Brain blast.
Yeah, like, you get that feeling, like, yeah, like, it literally brings you back to, like, a moment, whether it's, like, carefree, you know, like, you're just living, or whatever it is. So I think the NFT space is one of those things that has the ability to do that in a creative way. And so things that do that, I think, are kind of things that I choose to invest in. So just, I'm not ever really picking what's been done. I want to pick what connects with people.
Okay, so on that topic, freaking mind blown with the nostalgia factor. Like, thanks. I'm just picturing a freaking SpongeBob NFT, and you click on it. I'm ready. Let's go. Take all my money, baby. But
dude, there's so many levels. It's like, mm-hmm. We haven't even explored the auditory, like, really factor.
We're just in profile pictures. Yeah.
No, it's like, nah, this is the Nest, bro. We're at Nest, Atari in the space, dude, right now.
Yeah, it's like Gary Vee said. He's like, you don't care about NFTs, you better, because your fucking your ticket to Coachella in 4 years is going to be an NFT. So
yeah,
like, everything's going to be an NFT. And it's so crazy how you can monetize and put a community and then a mission, and then everyone's economically incentivized to participate, to grow it, to expand it. Mm-hmm. Johnny put that idea out to me. It's like, dude, take the network marketing model and put it on an investment. And that's NFTs.
Yeah, bro,
or you talk 100%. About them, or you tell people about them. The more valuable they'll bring, and the more people they bring, you know, it grows. But what are you looking at right now, man? What NFTs? I saw you made a Twitter post. Like, you were asking about the Bears, or
I got the people going,
or the Quirkies, right? The Bears or the Quirkies.
So it's funny that you mentioned that, and I chose those two specifically because they're unique in their own ways. For example, OK Bears, that's an NFT project on Solana. They don't do anything really. Like, it's not like they have, like, purpose, you know. It's not like they're like, oh, X percentages goes back to saving the Bears. There's nothing. It's not like that.
Their marketing is good though. Like, the whole, like, we're in a bear market, it's gonna be okay. Like,
oh yeah. So okay, that's bear. The thing.
The art is great too.
The art. It's a copy and of Fort Abe's. The art.
It's it's a lot of. There's a lot of similarity, a lot of synchronicity there. But it's, again, the thing is right there, bro. It's like, what I realized, man, right now. What's working really well is branding. It's branding, bro. The people are building brands, and that's why, like, why did people originally buy Nike shoes? It was like one word, psychologically, Michael Jordan, and it was, you know, just do it. And I guess just the symbol itself, I guess psychologically people fuck with it, but this is just branding, and people are behind it. So, like, what, like, the mantra, WAGBO, we're all gonna be okay. And so it's not like, oh, it's not hype, it's not how we're gonna make it. It's like, we get, like, it's just like, so seeing the culture behind that, seeing the way people rally behind this message, and on top of that, there's just, like, specific moments. So some companies get a moment. The best companies get like two or three, and legacy companies every couple years, like, they just get this, like, moment that defines them. And this had their moment when it minted, because it did the most volume in Solana history in its first 24 hours and enough to top all of NFTs, like Ethereum. So this was the first thing to really show ETH NFT buyers, like, yo, what? Like, they're in our territory right now. What's this all about? And so that was the first defining moment where all of a sudden it's like, wait, what the, like, yo, they just popped off. Like, they just took over for today. So that's one thing. And it's like, all right, cool. That like sticks with you. And then all of a sudden, all right, they become the fastest to ever get to 100 sold. Ever. Damn. And then all of a sudden, they're about to be, they have the number one most volume in Solana history. They're not number two. And it's been like 2 weeks, bro. So all of these things, it's not that I give a fuck. Like, to me, I don't actually care that much, but everybody else does. And that's what I trade. I trade beliefs. I trade the timing of people's belief systems. And so with that project, I'm like, yeah, all right, cool. This is about to run up because everyone genuinely just believes it. And the reason I'm trading it, because the thing is, I'm not just buying, I'm trading this because it's so volatile. Like, people love it. It dumps. People buy it back up again. It drops. So I'm like, all right, dude, this is fluctuating 30 to 50 Solana a day. Bro. Okay. Let me just scoop a floor, ride it high. What do I know how to do best? Understand the flows of the market. Like, all right, bet. So trading wise, I'm like, this is such a no-brainer to have some. And of course, like, there's some strategy so that, you know, let's say it goes for a crazy run and then you're like, dude, no, I don't have one. Like, I missed it. You know, you have a couple, whatever. But OK Bears, it was like, this is kind of the what's become like the leading movement right now. There's a couple other really good ones that actually are doing more, like D-Gods. They literally bought a professional basketball team, which the funny thing is the play wasn't even having a team. It was the branding, the marketing, the exposure that having that team does for them. So those guys think different. So yeah, that's kind of why I was like, all right, here's this hot, you know, up and coming project. And then, all right, here, the other one was Quirky's, which is like, man, it's a cult. It's a cult. It's a cult. Like, the amount of engagement that I got on that tweet from at least 50 to 100 different people, just like, yo, like, this is it. Like, and then the art is sick. There's just so many unique things to it. And everyone just is so wholesome in the space. And I got to see it start. Like, we got our first ones, like, pretty early, but we got to see the creation, like, the cultivation of intention, of the energy, of the vibe. Because that's the thing, like, it's like, for example, professional teams, every team has like their own culture, you know, like the Boston Celtics back, you know, back in early, like late 2000s, early 2010s, like they were like kind of like the bad boys. Like, they're just like, they don't fuck with us. Like, that was kind of the energy. Other like teams or businesses or cultures, they all just have like a different like sentiment. And so seeing Quirky's is like, cool, what are they doing? Like, what are they like providing to the world? And for them, it's like, they're building a brand, dude. They're building like one of those things that people just love because, one, they just love each other. Two, of course, they want, you know, price to go up, but they're just like, they've created this culture because they're doing Twitter spaces every day. So every day, everyone's getting to know each other more. Everyone's like kind of feeling the vibe. So it's not, now they're not just like behind this PFP. All of a sudden there's communication, there's contribution. Yeah. So it's like community. And I remember one of the things that I learned from you, man, years ago, it was like, how do you build a good community? And I remember you're like, I think the best communities are the ones where any single person feels like they're contributing. Exactly. And it's not just up to a couple of people. And so I've seen that. I've seen that. And so anyways, like, these are just some things that I kind of saw in that, in ETH and Quirky's, and I was like, yo, like, this is a, they're two different plays.
Yeah.
One is like, let me catch momentum. Let me like go up and down. The other one is like, I would not be surprised if that project goes eventually just goes in 10, 20, you know, becomes a blue chip in the future. So yeah, I guess that's like kind of my mindset behind Buff was like different things. Timelines might be different, but yeah, go at it.
Yeah, I think the Bears definitely have the market attention and the money flow. But yeah, just my experience with Corky's, that vibe, the community vibe that Corky's give off, bro. It's like, I don't know what y'all doing, but I feel it. I feel it. Kind of follow-up question with the whole like community and leadership. I think my biggest thing I'm looking at with NFTs, it's like looking into, because like I don't know much about the Corky's. I don't know much about the Bears. You know, I'm familiar with the Bored Apes. I know Yuga Labs is behind the Bored Apes, you know, yeah. And like, and the project that I've showed on this podcast and I'm and participating with myself with 8-Bit. I'm definitely a huge fan of the founders of the people. And I think that's kind of where my mind is at with NFTs. It's like, okay, yeah, they launch an NFT. They have a great community. That's almost like you have to have that. But how much influence do you think leaders have in NFTs? How much influence do you think they should have? Do you think things should be more community-based? But then the caveat of that, obviously, if you have something that's completely community-driven, you don't have leadership and direction, you know, to where to actually take the project. So how much influence for you does, like, the founders of an NFT project have? Do you care? Do you not care? Are they super important? And where do you think that middle ground is with, you know, leaders running NFT projects versus having a project be community-driven? I think that's a big thing that NFTs really experiment with, is like, you know, you're incentivizing ownership, you're giving ownership through these NFTs. So where does your mind go when you think of that, when like maybe creating your own NFT one day, how would you structure it? Maybe posing the question, is that better that way? But like, if you're getting what I'm getting at with the dynamic between leadership and 100%. Participants in NFTs.
100%, that's a really good question. I think the community always chooses anyways. Like, the community chooses to follow or not. So with D Gods, Frank is chosen. Like, he's you know, he's the leader of the project. Obviously he's making things happen, but I think he does a good job. His role is so valuable because the community fucks with him so heavy, bro. Like, they're like, dude, Frank, you know, like, everyone just loves this dude. And so he's been chosen to lead. He's not leading for the attention or to, you know, drive it. It's like, all right, cool. There's this back and forth. There's this exchange with Quirky's, like, their leader, he's involved, but he doesn't need to be like leading like crazy because the community does so much of the talking. Like, the community stands around. There's like sub leadership. There's delegation, there's culture. So it's like, they don't need a face because what has become the face of Quirky's is the people. It's not somebody. So I think that's the thing, is everything at the end of the day, it's always community driven, but whether or not the community chooses their leader to be a face or not, and your ability to understand that, I think that makes a huge difference. And then sometimes that's why you see some projects fail, is because someone decides to continue to lead even though they're not the chosen ones to lead.
So if we kind of parallel this conversation, like, we're speaking a lot about branding and community, which I think has been, in my opinion, one of the biggest reasons why you've been able to help so many people, is because of the opportunity that you've had to educate possibly millions of people now on the market and investing and trading and things like that. So if you had to start, like, if that opportunity of educating people didn't come to you, knowing what you know now, how would you build your own personal brand to where it's at now without having that platform?
So, and I think this answer should be different for anybody. But I think what's important first is just like, what do you stand for, dude? What do you want to actually do? Because like, I can tell you the easy thing, like, there's easy things to do. Like there's things that you can do that are going to capture attention, you know, because that's, you want to make money in the world. All right, cool. Capture attention, monetize attention. It's really fucking simple. But the question that you asked me was, if I'm going to build, like, right, you were basically saying, like, if I'm going to build my brand from zero, I had no leverage and I'm just restarting, what would that look like? And I think it would be really built on contribution, man. Like, one thing that, it's funny because I think one of my biggest handicaps, one of my biggest crutches, is the fact that I kind of already have, I automatically kind of get a funnel of people that help me build my brand. Because the way like our company is built out is there's going to be new people that are, you know, going to be experiencing my mentorship, even if I personally wasn't the ones who went and brought them into my mentorship. So I have a funnel of new people all the time. They get exposed to me and the way I think and all these things. And so the reason I say I think that's my crutch is because now I'm not going and actually creating the value, you know, publicly. All my value mostly is private. So in a way, I'm like a hidden gem, because you have to get exposed to our company in order to be like, oh, like this is here. Whoa, like this guy thinks different. And so the reason I bring this up is because that allows me to understand, okay, well, what would I do differently? Because now my biggest crutch is that I have a funnel. I don't need to go and build an audience if it just comes to me. So if I'm going to build something, you got to give it all away, man. Like all the sauce. All the sauce. And I heard something. It was, you know, give all the information, sell the implementation. So give all the information, sell the implementation. And I was thinking about it and I was like, damn. Because it's true, man. We heard it so many times. Knowledge is in power. Applied knowledge is. And what takes the most effort, what takes the most reprogramming, you know, what's that hurdle that most people just absolutely just like crash into? And it's execution. And so, you know, one, know what you want to stand for, know what you want to give. So for me, like, I'm grateful because I've built up, man, the amount of conversations that I've had that start with a problem and need to end in a solution. Like that's my role in my life is give me all your fucking problems so that I can just like, you know, transform them into a solution oriented experience. And like, that's it. Like, that's all I fucking do all day, every day. And so, and I love it. I love it.
That's literally our relationship in a nutshell, bro. Like, for real. Like, I hit you up. I'm like, yo, I need some help with this thing that I can't figure out how to solve. And then you just like, boom, one text message.
Yo, there's a lot of power and simplicity, man. But yeah, man, I guess that's like it. Like, I'm grateful, bro. I'm grateful because, and someone asked me this a long time ago, and they're like, yo, I feel like I attract a lot of energy to me. And I was like, what do you mean? They're like, well, like, I feel like I attract a lot of good things, but I feel like I also attract a lot of bad things. And I was like, okay. And she's like, how do I work with it? Like, what do I do? And I was like, well, I think I experience what you experience. And it's not that you attract bad things, but you attract people that are going through bad moments. And all of a sudden you have all this weight. All right. Cause because there's people that I think are just like beacons of energy. And like, it's just like, things are just coming to you, like a whole bunch of things, all kinds of things. And I think our ability to like transmute that, our ability to transform that, that's what leads to whether it's fulfillment or success in whatever definition that you have for it. And I think that's the key. It's my perception of a problem or of a moment that you didn't want to experience. It's like, all right, cool. How do I flip this? How do I flip this into my favor? Or how do I, you know, because perception's a higher faculty. So like, all I got to do is look at this from the right angle and all of a sudden, cool, it's for me. All right, but so Honestly, I don't remember the question, bro. I just went off on a tangent. but yeah,
that's good. I think the value, dude, that that's just like you just talking. It's like I don't even remember the question, but the value that you were just dropping, like it leads to different thoughts in my own mind that are just so so deep. I think we've covered a few different things here. I think kind of like finish off the subject here of like money. Is this your first full market cycle, like of euphoria? You know, like that picture you posted something the other day.
Oh yeah.
You know, of the secret of the transfer of wealth, right? Is this the first full market cycle? Well, I guess it's not a full one yet, right? But we're getting there. Is this the first one that you've been through?
No, actually, it's not. So I think that's where I kind of get a different approach to it, and that's also kind of why, like, I almost don't even give a fuck. It's just like, dude, man, we've been through this. Like,
relaxed right now, man.
Yeah, I've already been through this shit. Like, all right, cool. For some background for people who don't, you know me or some of my story, I saw Bitcoin at $7 like in 2012 or something. And I chose to buy shrooms instead. And it might have been a good idea. Who knows? But I just didn't know what Bitcoin was. I didn't know it was investable. I didn't know, you know, and I didn't also have the forward thinking of finding out or anything. It was just like, oh, whatever, fuck that. I'm 17, like, I want to get high. And then I saw it again the next year in my freshman year of college, my first semester, and I saw it all year. There was an app that, there was a Twitter account called Trutherbot. And every day it would just give me an alert, like Bitcoin at $100, Bitcoin at $200. And I remember it's just every single day, like I'm not, and this, I was so active on Twitter back in 2013, 2014. And every single day, I was like, you see it every day, but it means nothing to you. So many things we see every day and it means nothing to us until it does. And that's what happened to me. So I didn't do anything. And then eventually I bought in like around like $1,800, I think is when I got my first, like my first little taste of crypto, and then, you know, wrote it up and made some money on the way up. Saw it go up to, you know, a little under 20K, right around those times. I also had been accumulating like XRP. I didn't really get it even. I was buying some. And then I had one of my biggest trading days, margin trading XRP after like the peak, because XRP had a delayed like pop. And so I just had my first 5-figure like that. And I was like, holy shit, that was crazy. And then it all died. And then she died and it was cold, cold winters. And that's when Jordan got into crypto. Jordan got into crypto after the all time highs with Bitcoin. It was like, I remember it was like Christmas, New Year's Eve ish times in 2017 when, I was in Minnesota and fucking freezing cold, and Jordan's like, bro, dude,
the blockchain,
the blockchain is the future. I'm like, and he's like, bro. And I remember, like, because I know what that moment's like. I remember, like, just be, like, it just blows your mind, and you're like, what? Like, you question everything. You know, you can't look at money the same. You can't look at anything the same. So many different fundamental principles of trust and what even is value in money, and all of a sudden you're like, dude, what? I know nothing.
It's the ultimate rabbit hole. It's like politics, yeah. Government, money, everything all in one.
Seriously, it's a lot. Like, to say it's just like crypto is the most understood. How do I say that? Yes, it's the most understood word, and it's so over, like you hear the word crypto and it's just like, sometimes, you know, and yeah. But it's like it means so much more than what it really is. Mm-hmm. But it is an absolute. It's a rabbit hole for sure. But yeah. So I got to see the whole pop. It wasn't like I did make money, but it wasn't like, oh my god, I became a millionaire. It was just like, oh, this is cool. Like, this is possible. It expanded my mind for sure. But then it was 2 years of just like tundra. You know, it's just like nothing really happening for a long time. Nothing too significant, at least. and but a lot of learning, a lot of education. So what I'll say is, like, this is the time to just throw away. Sorry, the money train's coming by here. I don't know if you guys can hear it. But this is the time to get educated, man. Like, don't fall into the emotions and into the sound of the media. Take the time to really, like, figure out what your role might be in the space. You know, for everyone listening, like, don't sleep on it because it's in a downtrend, or they're not at favorable prices. This is probably the better time to be more involved. I'm not saying go and buy anything, but, like, go and dive deep and detach from time. That's been one of the most helpful things for me, is detach from time over results.
I got a fun question. You guys ever seen Super Step Brothers? Obviously.
Yeah.
So, you know that scene where they're like, I don't remember exactly what the scene was, but I remember the quote where it's like, they just look at each other and they're like, did we just become best friends? What was that for you two? Like, what was that? Like, what was it, a party? Was it like after in the morning, you know, was it like walking home, walk of shame? What was that thing?
I remember, but I want to hear Jordan. I want to see if Jordan and I had the same moment.
Dude, no, I want to hear you speak first, because I'm like, there's a lot of moments. Yeah, you got to go first. I gotta bring mine out.
So like, Jordan and I, like, I think our first year that we, like, kind of knew each other, it was just like homies from afar. It wasn't just like, yo, like, we're chilling. It was like, the only time we would hang out is if, like, Akash and someone else, like, would, like, they'd set it up and then we'd end up either, like, going out with them or, like, running to some party.
I remember now.
So we'd end up getting, like, stupid. But I think, if I remember correctly, the first time that, like, I was just like, yo, nah, this is my dude. Like, this is my G. Like, I fuck with this guy. It was like, we had just gotten our new apartment. We had just gotten our apartment. It was our sophomore year.
It was music.
And it was music. Yeah. Yep. I remember, I don't know if I was playing Logic or Jordan was playing Logic. But he, like, Logic was on, and we were both just like bumping, just like, oh snap, this goes crazy.
Yeah.
And then it trickled. So it was like, yo, wait, you fuck with Mac Miller? Dude, no way. You know about this? And then all of a sudden it was just like that moment. So yeah, music definitely was the underlying fact. Because it's like, you it's like one of those things that if you can appreciate something like music, then you probably have other things in common too.
Facts. It was Welcome to Forever. Logic, that mixtape, bro, before his first album, bro. Like, and then J. Cole, Kendrick, Good Kid, Mad City. There was a lot of good mixtapes. Dizzy Wright was hot back then. Futuristic.
We were the XXL freshman.
The XXL freshman hip hop days, man.
that was definitely it. That was the beginning. That was the moment. Obviously, we both also enjoyed marijuana.
And then lots of acid. Lots of acid trips after that sealed the bond forever. So,
yeah, no, that's how you do it, man.
bro. Mikey's brought me back from fucking some weird places, man. Like, some weird places in my mind. That's why I had to show that meme in the beginning, because literally Mike's that guy. Like, if Mike didn't exist, I would probably be talking to a wall somewhere still.
But you know what? Like, I remember we had a season. There was like this season in 2017, summer of 2017. Yep. And it was highly
Pilsen,
psychedelic induced. Yeah. Like, it was just a lot. There was a lot.
LCD sound system.
It wasn't like negative, or like, it wasn't like a task. It was just like, we were just excited. we were excited to explore our minds. You know?
Yeah. We were productive. It was just like, we got out of our, like, let's go get drunk and get girls face. Like, we were done with, like, let's just go be stupid. We're just exploring. Like, yeah, we were all like 22, 23. We were pretty much all finishing college, looking for the next thing in life. And it's so crazy because that was that summer. Yeah. We experimented with that stuff and lots of different things. We'd have conversations, and it wasn't like let's just get wild and have sex and play music all the time. It was actually like legitimately like, who the fuck are we? What are we doing here? And then, dude, that literally, have you ever looked at it like this, Mike? Like, we did that for that whole month, and then that literally led directly into what we're doing now. Like,
yeah, it was Yeah, dude. That was a pre-workout.
That was a pre-workout. Hey, for anybody listening, as you want to go to the next phase in life, that's the secret right there.
Make sure you got a good spirit guide, though. Make sure you got a good spirit guide.
No, you know, but those times, I remember, because it was actually a little bit before the summer too. I think it was like spring into summer, like that whole season. But I remember there was I would say, like, we were all just on our shit, dude. Like, all of us were just focused on just, like, becoming that, like, that person, you know, becoming the best version of us, you know, whether it was, like, gym, spiritual development, personal development, understanding all these different things. And I remember you were reading The Celestine Prophecy. Mm-hmm. This is such a, like, if I could say the moment where, like, all right, 100% definitely I'm in a new season now, was that moment. Like, that was the new season of the special. And that book, man, it was just so intentional. And it wasn't like mind-blowing material. Like, if you read it now, it's like, oh, cool. Like, this is cool. But where I was, and I think where we all were, which was just discovery, there was just so many things about, you know, the past, present, like your relationship with, you know, people, certain people in your life, relationship with money, relationship with success, all these different things that, all these different belief systems. But I remember you started reading that book and I was like, I remember you like read the first chapter and you were like so serious.
Yeah, I remember that.
Because you were going through, like, we were both are kind of like entering a specific little bump in the road moment in our lives, relationship wise.
Females involved, yeah.
Females were definitely involved. And I remember you read like the first chapter and you stopped and you were just like fucking dramatic, just like, like, wow, whoa. And you're like, dude, I'm questioning everything. And I was like, all right, hi, ass. And then, but the thing was, is like, it didn't end. Like, then all of a sudden you finished the second chapter and you're just like, you were serious. Like, we started talking about certain stuff. And then the third chapter, remember, you finished the third chapter and you're like, bro, I need you to read this. You're like, this is life. This is changing my life right now. And you wouldn't ever just say things like that. And I was like, damn, all right. And then all of a sudden, all of us were reading the same book. At the same time, like, all of us entered this quest of understanding. And yeah, dude, that was one of the most like significant moments in my life for sure.
Sure. Me too.
And I was just like, holy shit. Like, I learned so much about myself.
I think we all came from like a very, I studied science. I studied engineering. Andrew studied science. Peter was studying science. I know, Mike, you were studying business. And I think we all looked at ourselves as like very logical, very like forthright, competitive dudes coming up in the world. Like, yeah, we're going to go get it. Like, this is how life is type shit. And like, for me, I remember that book changed everything because it unlocked the spiritual perspective of life for me, of achieving, of like understanding how to go forward and get and become more in life in a way that's other than just like, and the honestly put it frankly, like we were straight up bros. Like we were the bros, like drink beer, go hard, lift weights, let's kill it. Yeah. Like that was 100%. Who we were. And then we found this stuff that's like the power, the law of attraction, the power of manifestation. You're like, whoa. What is this? Like, yeah. This is whoa. Like that was my introduction to all of that. Like all of the spirituality concepts, all those things. Yeah. It was such a transformative time for sure. Combined with all
so many steps too. Like, yeah. I remember playing, Outward in the Devil.
Mm-hmm.
I played the audio of Outward in the Devil on the TV. You know, what's hilarious. Like when we moved into this apartment, we all like moved in together, Jordan, our friend Andrew, my brother Kevin, and the first thing we bought, no couch, a 65 inch or 70 inch TV. No couch, nothing was in the place. We bought a 65, 70 inch TV for the sake of it being hilarious. Like we knew it was outrageous and just mental, but we did it because
we mounted that shit on the wall too. Literally had a flat screen mount on the wall in an empty room. Like
Yeah, it was like big ass TV, a bong, and nothing else. And
you gotta have the bong, remember, and then we're gonna have the TV.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, like what else are you gonna do? You know? And so, but I remember playing that out loud, and it was like, and for those of you who've never heard or listened or read Winning the Devil by Napoleon Hill, the audio, like the guy's voice is very like it's just very distinctive. And so all of a sudden it's a, you know, it's a conversation between being and the devil. And they want them walking in, they're like, what the fuck are you listening to? Like, dude, what is this shit? And I'm like, yo, just sit down and like just sit down and listen. And I remember from there, it was like I would come home from work because we were working so much too. And then it would be playing, and I'm like, oh, here we go. All right. We're in the journey of enlightenment. But yeah, it was, there's a lot of like, I mean, there's always like a lot of catalysts in the different journeys of like our progression. And I like what you said earlier. You're like, on a spiritual level, you understood kind of what, or you started to understand what achievement was like, what it is to go and achieve, but like on a spiritual plane. Cause I think there's this like, get money, you know, like mindset, which I feel like if you really know what money is, then cool, like that's dope. But when it's like a empty get money, I feel like that could be a dangerous path. You know, it just depends, I guess. But I think definitely I remember just undergoing a different, there's like a different approach. Like you're almost doing the same things, but the way in which you do it is different because internally you're fueled by like for different motives, or you're like, I don't know, you're like learning more about why you want to go and do or be these things.
Yeah, big facts.
How's that, man? You guys have some history, man. That's awesome. Shout out to you guys, bro, for staying in touch for this long. A lot of people just kind of go through life, don't grow through life, and end up just like not being homies with the people that they were homies with, you know, in the past. But I think you guys are connected outside of this world, and that's what remains you guys attached. So.
That's Mike's like, that's, Jordan, where are you? Oh shit, there he is. Let's go. There's my friend.
That's so lit. Yo, man. So, I mean, I wish we could talk on here forever, man. This is like so many, there's so many things that like you are just so wise about that. I don't know if you've ever thought about writing a book, or, you know, maybe you should. Yeah. I would read it. I would read it twice. you know, but that's definitely, you're a very wise person in a lot of different spectrums of life, man. I wish we could pick your brain for forever. We've been going for an hour and a half now, and it feels like we've been talking for like 5 minutes. So we're respectful of your time.
I made time, man. I know me, and I know like this group together. So I was just already mentally prepared for, you know, 90 minutes, 2 hours, whatever. Like I've seen, because like I follow podcasts, you know, like I fuck a podcast, and you know, there's some that last like, you know, 30 minutes, 40 minutes, an hour, and then all of a sudden it's like 3 hours and 30 minutes. And I'm like, oh shit, this one's going to be good. Cause that only happens when it's natural. That only happens when it's like, there's this just genuine connection. It's organic. And cause that, bro, man, what I realized is like one of the things that I think helped me, or I've discovered over time, is you got to throw away all the rules.
Facts.
All the boundaries, all the expectations, and just kind of like, do what feels right. Because my journey in the beginning was definitely not normal. You know, Jordan lived with me, so you got to see it. Like, I just didn't really sleep for a year and a half.
Dude, fucking sicko mode. Like, motherfucking sicko mode. Excuse my language, but my dude, unreal work ethic. They're like crazy. The most insane. School, work, trade. I don't think he slept for a year. Like, I was there. Like, I think he did.
Shout out to Red Bull.
Yeah. Oh yeah, dude, we'd have cases of that shit.
I worked for Red Bull for a while, and so the Red Bull girls would drop off like cases of Red Bull at my spot, because you have to like hand them all out, like there's like a quota you got to meet, and you know, like at the end they still have like a case or two cases left of Red Bull, and they would just like pull up to our spot and then just drop off all this Red Bull for us.
We drank it.
And we definitely drank it, dude. It was bad. But yeah, like that kind of like that phase in my journey, it wouldn't, I don't know if I would be here if I didn't go through that. And that was just my journey. Like, you don't gotta grind, you know, you don't gotta be that person. I think some people, when they are that person, it takes them to different places. Cause like, I think there's people that can be Gary V and like that amplifies you and you just go and do greatness. And then I think there's people that maybe just aren't aligned with that, or that's not something that they would do, but they try to do it and it's the opposite effect and it makes everything worse. So I think it's either you have to understand like the drive behind some kind of that kind of work ethic, or maybe it's just like not meant for everybody. I don't really know the answers there, but that has kind of always been my approach. And I think the reason it works for me is because I don't feel like I'm working hard. I just feel like I'm doing what I want to do. And I think, you know, there's a book that I know Jordan has read as well, or I think you read it, Power versus Force. At least I know you're aware of it, but that's a book where like I just learn kind of where to come from to do the things that I want so that I'm not exhausted. And like the foundation of what I, at least the things that I do, like that I like to do, I know I'm doing them. So I don't really get exhausted because I've come to learn about myself a lot. And I'm driven by people. Like, I think I was talking to you, Mondo, about this maybe, I don't know, a couple of weeks ago or something. But I know that if I make a responsibility, if I make like a promise or whatever to people, I'm gonna fall through with it. Like, I have to. And that's just like, that for me is, this works. Like, if I said, yeah, man, I'm gonna be up at 4 a.m. to do help you with this, it's because like, it's like, I don't want to wake up. Dude, I want to fucking wake up. But it's like, I just know people are counting on me. And like that for me, bro, that works every single time. It's like the feeling of I let someone down, bro, that obliterates me. So like, that's why that I can go and do certain things that seem just ridiculous. Like, it's like, dude, you never stop. It's like, I don't really feel like I need to. You know, like I just, because I feel like I'm being fueled by, I feel like it's Tesla's coil for me. It seems like free energy because it's comes from people, and there's unlimited amounts of people who have unlimited amounts of, you know, solutions that they need. And so I just feel like I'm running, I kind of have like a permanent energy because it's just like comes from people. So that's what's come to really help me in work over time. Because I think if you don't understand it, like where it comes from, then I don't think you can sustain it.
Dude, so let me give you some context before I ask you this question. One of the people that you said that was like missing in your mentorship was Hermosi. And he just did a podcast. I'm sure you watched it. And the guy who was asking him, he was talking about his like great or like four great grandfathers ago, like had 400 children and like was super, yeah, super wealthy. Right. And like he himself doesn't believe in legacy. Right. So you're doing all these things, man. You're impacting all these people.
Did you say 400?
Yeah. 400. Yeah. 400. Yeah. Like hella wives. Yeah, man. Like, the guy was busy, man. Oh, the guy was busy.
Genghis Khan.
He was like an actual king of Iran.
That's crazy. Sorry to interrupt.
No, yeah, that's important. I don't know if those are standards, I guess. But my question was this, you're like doing all these things, man, and you're so humble about all the things that you do. And I think it goes over a lot of people's heads that like you really do help a lot of people. What, like, do you believe in legacy, or are you just like doing this just because you're just like here for now, for the time being? And I hope we had a whole another 6 hours to talk about what you think happens after that. But like, do you believe in legacy? Like, do you think that when your time is up, like you're actually going to be remembered for these things, or are you just like here presently at the moment?
I don't care. That's it. I don't care. Like, I don't know. Like, to me, and again, like, and everything I say, like, I could be wrong. I'm not coming from a place of fact. Actually, I don't think facts are even real, but to me, I feel like legacy is also kind of ego. Like, I don't know. Like, I feel good. Of course, I feel good helping people. Like, I feel good being part of people's growth, even if it's like 1%. And it's one thing I said, you know, contribution feels fucking good to me. Like, fulfillment. It's funny because it's like, oh, cool. Like, I feel good for helping you. So, like, is that greedy? But it's like, it's almost selfish in a way, right? But I think it's okay. It's a good selfish. But yeah, to me, legacy, like, I don't do something to be remembered. You know, I just think it's like my moral obligation. That's really it. Like, if people remember me, dude, that's fucking dope. Like, that's dope. I don't care. I don't need you to remember me. I want you to, I want like the values or whatever it is that you, whatever shift you had, like whatever value, whatever you felt internally, I want that to be remembered. I want that to be passed on. Like, as a person, you, I could be faded into the oblivion, whatever. I don't give a shit. But if like just the value or whatever feeling it is that you, you felt that felt like changed you, and if that's passed on, bro, that's fucking dope. So to me, like, I don't care to really build a legacy. It's cool. Like, bro, I think it speaks for itself. It's like, all right, cool. You do something remarkable and it like lasts a lifetime or, you know, decades, and you become, you know, Jesus Christ, like you're just remembered forever. That's incredible. You know, there's people like that, Abraham Lincoln, you know, like, I'm not going to go into that, but there's people that have been around for, you know, hundreds and centuries and millennia, and that's amazing. But I don't know, to me, legacy, it's like, I'm here to build a legacy. When I hear that, I'm like, all right, cool, it's about you then. So, yeah. I guess like, nah, I'm not really here to build legacy.
That's deep, man. Yeah, I wanted to ask you that ever since I heard him say that, because I don't know. To me, I think it was, and this is, I think, was ego for me, but I was like, man, I want to be here because I want to die. And, you know, I want there to be hundreds of thousands of people at my funeral because I want to be remembered forever, you know? And it's like, and then I heard Hormozy say like, yeah, like, you know, 3-4 generations from now, people aren't going to remember who you are, like, regardless of your accomplishments. Like, this guy had 400 kids, you know, ran an empire, and he doesn't even remember his name, you know? And I was like, wow, that's incredible. Cause it's true. You know, unless you're, you know, somebody of I guess like true significant impact in the planet, it's very difficult for people to know that. And he's just like, I'm just this tiny little guy, like thinking I'm going to build this giant legacy. I was curious to kind of hear
this. I'll say this though. I think like, if you want, like, if you feel like that feeling internally, like, dude, I want to do something so remarkable that it's remembered for the history of time, then go fucking do it, dude. Like, I think if it's like, oh, well, I mean, it's difficult. Like, fuck that. There's no point. I don't like that. Like, I don't like that mindset. Cause then it's all of a sudden like, okay, like it's just hard. So it's probably not even possible. Mm-hmm. So why even bother? I'm about like, bro, if it's impossible, go do it. Who gives a fuck? Mm-hmm. Like, if you got that itch, bro, like, oh, you gotta go get it.
Do you think that those people that are remembered for all time, though, do you think they intended to be remembered? Or do you think there was just like the fucking time and place and they were that dude, they got chosen almost to be remembered?
So like, yeah, bro. It's like what we talked about with, okay, should there be a leader? Should it be community driven? It's like, bro, the people choose. Exactly. People always choose.
Right.
It's like, you didn't choose. You did. Mm-hmm. It's like, for example, what's more important, who you are or your results?
Mm-hmm.
Who you are. So like, who you are is what can, you know, the consequence can be a legacy.
Transcend.
But it's like, right. So it's like, mm-hmm. I don't think you build a legacy. I think you get given the legacy.
Right. Exactly. Yeah.
Dang. Man, that's deep, man. That's fire. Wait, I'm going to go rewatch this and take notes, man, because there's a lot of just like subtle things that you say. And it's just like, because you don't stop and like, you know, in like speaking engagements, people stop and let the effect hit, you know, but you just keep on going. It's like, oh, you just might have missed it. You might have missed it.
You know, it's funny. I should be better at that because I literally speak as a preferred profession. But I also, I don't know, like, in a way, it's like when you make that dramatic pause, it's like, bro, not everything I say is that fucking epic. You know, so I don't want to be that guy where it's like, oh, my job. And then
I think it's
then
I think it's just noteworthy that even in a conversation like this, like, there's no agenda. We didn't tell Mike, hey, this is what we're talking about. I was like, Mike, come on our show. We're just gonna chop it up. And like, the amount of value that comes out of that, bro, that just you having a conversation with us, the amount of value I gained, I know Armando gained, I know our audience gained a hell of an amount of value. So I just want to thank you for that, man. Just appreciate you for being here and just
I love it, man.
Being you, bro. You've been chopping it up. You're dropping bars left and right.
it's who we become, man. Shit. We it's what we do now. You kind of can't escape from it. You know what I mean? Like it just shows up. No, but I want to give it to you guys. Like, man, I see this is gonna be such a cool podcast over time. And I love this because like, actually, I want to hear from you guys. What, why did you guys decide to do this together? And just like, where, like, what's the, like, where you guys want to take it?
So I think for me, it was like, I think it was something that I had started, right? And you were actually on a few times, Jordan too. It was something that I had started and then not continued after time for X or Y reason. I'm not even entirely sure why. And then just the conversation with Jordan sparked and he was like, yeah, I'm going to start my own podcast. And I was like, well, like everybody's focused on like, you know, everybody's doing this. Like, why don't we just do it together? And like the impact that we can have from that, which is doing it together versus like growing separately, because Jordan's like super, like I look up to Jordan so much in a lot of different aspects. And it's like, but we can, at the same time, we can have a conversation that is just so powerful. And I think it was because, at Palm Beach
Airbnb.
Yeah. At Palm Beach, man. Like the conversations that we had there, like if we would have recorded those conversations for sure, probably would have built a legacy, you know, just because they were so powerful, just so raw, so uncut. And people just were like, wow, this is awesome. And I think just the number one, just the guy, like the experience that we've had in being able to carry conversations with people, but then just like naturally expand people's heads. So like I don't think this was like an intention of like, yo, let's, we didn't start with like, yo, let's do this together. I just hit him up one day. I was like, yo, let's just run it together. And he's like, all right, bet.
It just formed. Yeah, just it was a natural thing. It wasn't like we're gonna do this, we're gonna do a Joe Rogan style, we're gonna keep it open. For me, it was just like I've always having been in the industry, been an entrepreneur, being a person of like leadership, having that role of giving value to people, I've always been just kind of on the forefront of like, how can I deliver value the best way, the most digestible way, the most relatable way. And like, I'm a person that likes to cut it super real, super raw. Like, I don't want to give you the fakeness. So I'm like, dude, yeah, we just like, after being at the Airbnb and having those conversations, it's crazy because we'll just be talking to like one or two people, me or Mondo. And then all of a sudden, you know, there's 10 people. Yeah. There's a crowd, you know? And it's like, okay, I think when we just sit down and talk, it's valuable. Obviously, people, there's demand for this. So it's like, let's get on a mic and just chop it up and share our thoughts, share our feelings. It's public comments, like whatever comes up, comes up. And I think people do get a lot of value from the variety of it and then relating it to business, to trading, to tangible things where you can actually grow and get results. So yeah, I'm excited to see where it goes and what it turns into.
It's been cool too, because like we don't plan any of this. Like, so the first couple episodes, we like had a subject and we were like on that subject. We had a subject, but we didn't have a itinerary, so to speak. We didn't have questions prepared or anything like that. It's just raw conversations. It's like, oh, I'm gonna ask him a question, he's gonna ask me a question, and we're gonna go back and forth like that. And I actually had a lot of really good feedback from people that are like, yo, like, you guys are just like, how do you come up with these questions? I'm like, dude, like, we don't.
On the spot.
We just like talk, and it just like, so it's just so natural. So it's like these conversations, you know, people can't hold conversations. And I think that was one of the reasons why, like, it's so important to number one, educate yourself. And then two, like, listen, you know, like people, you can learn a lot from listening. What's helped me is listening, man. Like anytime that I hear you talk, Mike, like I'm always listening, bro. Whether it's like, whether you're talking to somebody else, I sometimes don't care to ask a question. Sometimes I'm just like, what does this guy have to say to somebody that I could take away? Because he's probably asked a question that I've already asked him, but in a different circumstance. Let me figure out how to learn. So this is a cool ass project. And I'm so grateful to have you on here, bro, for real. Like,
thanks.
Yeah.
Man, now what you guys are doing is so cool. Like, and you guys are the perfect people to do it. I know people, and people struggle with asking questions. And you guys know, I say this all the time. Quality of questions that you ask will lead to the quality of life that you live.
Facts.
So, I mean, y'all are building up some good quality over here. So I'm hyped, and it's cool because even for me too, just as a guest, I remember, I don't know who said it, but they were like, I wanna have, you know, whether it's my kids or grandkids or whether it's just, you know, 50 years down the line, I wanna know, like, how was I thinking?
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, what did I have on my mind? What did I have to say? And just have that documentation, have that, it's like, oh, all right, cool. Like, and you know how you said, I guess in a way, this is building a legacy because, you know, whether people want to or not, like, it's going to be on YouTube. It's going to be on Spotify. If those companies still exist in, you know, 20, 50 years, 100 years, which I feel like they probably will, which should probably say a lot about what to invest into. So, you know, on the spot, it's like, wait a minute, did I just convince myself to invest into something? But I think it's so valuable, and I definitely under document. And so you guys doing this, it inspires me to maybe not make a podcast, not yet, like it's just, I got too much going on, but at least just put more of what's in here out there so that it can just be digested more often, you know?
Please, for the rest of the world, for all of us, please do that. Yeah. I don't know about you guys. Like, for me, like, looking at documentation of my former self, is there's nothing more that inspires me more than looking at who I used to be, how I used to think, and be like, whoa, like, I remember that used to be, I remember writing this, and that was a big deal, and it turned out not to be. Just all the different insights and thoughts that come about from looking at a former version of yourself. Just so growth inspiring. So growth inspiring.
I was literally 2 days ago, I pulled out the journals from notes that I had when I first started with Mike. And, you know, a lot of the notes were, you know, they were like 4X, like candlesticks and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But some of the stuff was like journal entries that, you know, I've been unconsciously journaling for a while. Like, now I do it intentionally, but before I just did it just because I didn't know what else to do. And like, reading back on those things, I'm like, wow, this is who I was. That's kind of crazy. Like, this is how I was thinking 2, 3, 4, 5 years ago. It's insane. Yeah. And anytime, cool. Dude, anytime you got something on your head or on your heart, man, that you want to just like express out, maybe the next big NFT that you want to, you know, then you're more than welcome to come on here, man. Just let us know. We record every Friday, same time.
Y'all will get the inside scoop before everybody else, you know. How I'm doing. Nah, man, this is lit. You guys have, I'm sure you guys got really cool people coming on board. And if you guys want a special guest that you feel like you don't have access to, but I have access to, then you let me know, because I can make that happen probably. So that's the media networks right there. Man, like, I had yesterday, because I'm in Costa Rica, and I had some people over from the team, you know, aspiring traders, investors, and we're in the tallest building, I guess, in the country. I don't even know. And you know, the guy, you know, we're on the rooftop, and he's looking, and you see the whole country, like all of San Jose, all of it. And he's like, "Man, can I be honest with you?" I'm like, "What's up, bro?" He's like, "Before this, the highest I had ever been is 7 floors." And there was a couple people around, and they're like, "Yeah, dude, like I've never been around, you know, like I've never been, you know, 30 stories up in the air. I've never seen, you know, things like this." And I was like, damn, like, this was me 5 years ago, experiencing what I had never experienced. I don't know if you remember this, Jordan. When we went to Arizona in 2018, like spring of 2018, and we were in our first penthouse ever.
Yeah, dude.
And then the people, like, they lived across the sky from some of their homies who were like amazing entrepreneurs too. And it's like, dude, they're like all homies and they got these penthouses. And it was like expanding, you know, mind expanding. But to tie it all back together, that proximity, having that proximity made one of the more intangible or like seemingly stretching moments or experiences seem possible all of a sudden. Mm-hmm. It was just like, huh, wow, okay. So you know, having it and just making that reach to people who maybe are outside of your current income class, or people who just maybe their standards of living are much different than yours, find those people. Like anybody else doesn't, like, find those kind of people, because, you know, they're not going to give you the money. They're not going to give you the lifestyle, but their way of thinking might be so drastically different that that alone can start to shift the gears, you know, for you. And I just remember having those moments, like, over time, and it's always been a stretch. I've seen people do billion-dollar things now, and I'm just like, what? Like, and the human beings become desensitized to literally anything. Mm-hmm. Anything, like, by default. Like, you could, for example, like, Jordan could go and marry Scarlett Johansson, and it's the most goated thing of all time. And then a year later,
Andrew would be happy.
I'm not doing anything, don't worry.
But okay, Mondo's single. So Mondo,
yeah, I'd marry
Mondo
her.
Can go,
no doubt.
Mondo and marry Scarlett Johansson and whatever, you know, amazing person, and, you know, very, very beautiful. And then all of a sudden, it's like you will become desensitized to that. It mm-hmm. will just become normal to you. And that's why I think proximity, like, the best thing is for the better things in life to become normal to you. Mm-hmm. Like, that's, I think, the first step. And then once that's happening, then it's like, all right, hold up. How do I stay present and grateful with these things? Because otherwise, they're going to go away. If you don't appreciate and cherish something, you're not going to keep it.
Sheesh. Dude, we go on all over again. This not that. Yeah, dude. The mentorship of, like, giving the belief and the experience. That's something I've gotten the most out of mentorship from you, Mike, and from many as well. Which is so invaluable. But we have been here for a minute, shit, going on 2 hours now. We got some rapid fire for you, though. Some rapid fire.
Okay.
I'm gonna start easy. For me, it's gonna start easy and it's gonna get harder. But
I'm ready. Next,
as quick as you can do it, one word, one sentence, you know the drill. Mountains or beach?
All right. Mountains.
How do you stay focused?
I do as necessary.
City or country?
Long term, country.
Do you think Trump will get reelected?
No.
Pizza or tacos?
Tacos. If I wasn't vegan, fucking pizza.
Okay. Would you ever not be vegan?
Right now, it's not on the radar, but I'm open to anything always.
Okay. If you could have any superpower, what would it be?
Complete awareness.
I feel like you already have that, bro. What the hell?
That's like God status.
That's it. That's what I want.
All right. Jet, yacht, or supercar?
Jet.
Good choice.
If you could meet anyone, dead or alive, have a conversation with them, who'd it be?
Source.
That's not... Come on.
You would, man. It's one answer. All right, fuck it. Let's say not that one, okay?
Wait, what did you say? God. You said source?
Yeah, said source. Not God.
Okay.
This guy goes for, like, all time, bro. Like, he's just like...
Why? Why not? Why settle for, like, this little shit?
Yeah, true.
You know? I'm not here to settle for mediocrity, man. I don't want no pebbles. I don't want no crumbs. I want the fucking best, man. Peck, okay, one person. Damn. You got me on this one, but I don't actually know.
Side note, back to one of our conversations, though. Like, if you were to stick with Source, wouldn't you just have a conversation with yourself?
Yeah. That's 100%. That's it. So it's just, who are you?
God damn it. Here we go again.
I would say, if I could have a conversation with anyone, that's, like I said, like a physical entity, You want to put it like that.
That existed in this earth.
Yeah. It's okay. 3D, 3D, right? 3D.
Yeah.
I don't want to say Nikola Tesla because I feel like it's just a cop out. I feel like that one's too easy.
That's a really good one.
But I think that would be it because he's just someone that's done something that no one else at least has done again.
But he unlocked some shit that they locked back up. And yeah, exactly. Like,
tapped in. All right, if I could have unlimited access to anybody right now
at any
moment in time, that's alive right now, I think it would be Dr. Joe Dispenza.
Okay.
I feel like that dude's on something, man. Like, I don't know, man. Something about him, like, he's on some other shit that I don't know. But he healed his spine.
Like, he healed an unhealable spine injury with his mind.
I just seen him do things, man. I just seen him do things, which is, that's one of the things that he has, like events and stuff like that. A couple grand, like to show up and to be there for like a couple days. But it's definitely something I plan on doing, whether it's later this year or maybe next year. We should all do that together. Like,
down.
The people that I know that have, the people that I knew before are not the same from after that kind of event. Like, I genuinely see, like, they're very different. And they were already awesome. So they're now they're just like
more
kind of floating, bro. I'm just like, I want to float.
It's like is it like Tony Robbins where it's like all immersive, like?
Yeah, I haven't been at Tony Robbins event, but it's kind of like that. I think a bit more like a deeper spiritual, like scientific, you know? But yeah, something like that.
Word.
I had one more. I don't know. Did you have another one, Jordan?
No, that was it.
I got one more. I think this is a good way to kick it off. So, Mike, when your time here is done, by here I mean like physically, what are you gonna do with your wealth?
I'm just gonna give it all away.
I'll take some.
They can go. Whoever's next can go earn it. I'll leave them with what they need. Who they need to be, the key, jeez, so that they can be that person. Because if I give it to you, then I stole the most important, the most valuable thing. So, yeah, that's why, like, I think even money alone, like, they're like, yo, like, these people have billions. They can just, you know, like, give it all away and everything would be solved. And it's like, I don't think it would be, you know, like, I think poverty is all in the mind. And of course, there's lack of resources. Like, I'm not a fucking idiot. But to even the playing field, I think that's better than to just give so that you don't, like, if you can no longer lack money, but then there's everything else. So, like,
then what,
you know? All right, it'll redistribute itself.
Damn. Sheesh, man. What a bar.
It's been real fun.
You know, it's interesting is that I think that that's a very common theme with a lot of people that I look up to. It's like, we're just grinding so heavy to, like, take care of everyone that we can during the time that we're here, and then once we're here, it's just like, well, we can't take it, so, like, just give it all away. That's something that I listened to Jim Rohn, that audio, you know, Andrew Carnegie, we little Scotsman, you know, when he died, they found this little note. What did the note say, right? We spent half my life building as much wealth as I can, spend the second half of my life just giving it all away. So I think that's what you're doing now, man. You're just giving it away. It might not be physical wealth, right, but it is a lot of knowledge, a lot of really solid information,
which is more important, right? Because it's the principle, it's a biblical principle. You give somebody a fish, they eat today, but what's more important is teaching someone how to fish. And man, Mike, you've definitely taught me how to fish and been one of the biggest influences in that in my life in so many ways, not just financially, spiritually, finding my way back to this reality in so many ways, bro. So I'm just grateful, bro. I'm grateful to have you on here. I'm grateful we recorded such a dope conversation for so many people. Where can people find you, man? Where are you at on socials? How can they get in touch with you?
First and last name, man. Mike Navarrete. Really anywhere. Not really on Facebook too much, but, and I don't think anything I've ever done is even on Facebook. But if you want to kind of, I guess, see where we started and where we are, definitely through Instagram. I'm active on Twitter again. Crypto NFT Twitter is awesome. It's also really shitty. but it's also awesome.
Yep.
you can't have one without the other. But you can choose who you follow, so that is in your power. But yeah, that's it. YouTube. I mean, there's a couple things on there. That's kind of the one of the more. If I could say one thing I plan on doing is document more and publish it on everything. That's kind of like probably my number one priority. Because that's how you attract everyone instead of, you know, one at a time.
Looking forward to it, man.
Sheesh. Thank you, Mike. I appreciate you for being on here, man. Shout out to you for taking the time out of your day, man. I know you're in Costa Rica enjoying Pura Vida out there. So I appreciate you, bro. Say, make sure you ride that money train before you go.
definitely will, boys. Definitely will. Thanks for having me on, guys.
I appreciate you, bro. Jordan, see you next week, bro.
Peace out the next time, y'all.